This next question was sent in to CornyDriveThru@gmail.com from John Camacho in Northeast Ohio. Jim, first I wanted to thank you for all you have done for the sport of professional wrestling. I have had the pleasure of watching you and the Midnight Express face off against numerous tag teams at the Cleveland Convention Center and will always cherish those memories. My question is about the decision to replace the Mid-South TV title with a medallion. Whose idea was it? How was it regarded by the wrestlers? Were they a little off-put by the fact that it wasn't a traditional belt initially? I watched Terry Taylor beat Ted DiBiase for the North American title, Wild TV champion, and to me, it looked a bit odd to see him holding a small medallion in one hand and the massive North American title in the other.
Well, you know, actually, it was sort of like Goldilocks and the Three Bears. One was too small, and one was just plain too big. Neither was just right. Well, first off, none of the wrestlers gave two flying shits whether it was a belt or a medal, because they didn't care. And actually, the medal would have been something lighter that they could put in their bag and not have to schlep around. So the wrestlers weren't upset. I was not there when they did that. But apparently, and Brian, you know your Mid-South history, when they instituted the television title, did they have a belt to begin with and then go to the medallion, or did they do the medallion first? Because I remember the medallion.
I don't remember there being a belt.
Okay.
At all early on, no.
Then in that case, it was a deal where fucking, not only did Watts not want to buy a belt, I'm sure, but also they decided to make, since it was the TV title, make it different. And since they had so many amateur athletes in that territory, whether it was a Dr. Death or whether it was Rick Steiner or whether anybody, they win medals and medallions in the whether it be in the Olympics or in the, you know, NCAA or whatever. So that was the thinking behind it. And that's basically, there wasn't any other big conspiracy or any kind of, you know, deep thought into it otherwise than that. And as I said, the wrestlers didn't give a shit because it wasn't, especially in Mid-South and especially back in those days, it wasn't like today where all the guys were so thrilled when they suddenly won a championship. It was part of a bigger picture. You could, you know, was your money going to go up? Whatever. You were thrilled when you won the Mid-South title or the North American title or the Mid-South tag title because you knew you were going to be in main events and therefore your pay was going to go up. The TV title was just a way to get you on TV, which was a positive because you got a chance to have some more time on TV, but you were also probably going to fucking drop it several weeks after you won it because the TV title changed hands more often. So it wasn't a big deal in anybody's eyes. Did I say that, Brian, basically as clearly as possible?
I think so. When was the first time you heard about a wrestler being given a replica of the title they won? Because nowadays, wrestlers if a wrestler wins the World Heavyweight Championship, they get a world championship to take home.
Seriously?
I believe so. Like, UFC, when the UFC would have a championship, they would make like six belts. That way they had one for them, one for the fighter, one for the former champion. Like, they had multiple belts so they could just give them out.
But they came to be doing that with because every match on these big shows is for some title, because WWF has three world champions and a U.S. champion, a North American champion, seven sets of tag team champions, and they rotate constantly. They can't be giving away that many belts.
Well, they can't be giving away that many belts, but when you see these wrestlers and you see, like, sometimes photos of them at home in their little makeshift home office or man cave, and you see the belts in a...
Oh, yeah, well, no, I'm assuming they bought those themselves. I've never heard of the company actually giving a guy, here, you had the belts, and now here's your own to take home. You know, especially here's the thing. I've got a couple of replicas that I bought of the NWA World Tag Team Championship belts that we had in 86, the ones that I liked. I bought replicas of those myself. because I like those belts and they look good sitting here. So, but the company, Jim Crockett, didn't say, oh, here's take copies of the belts. They were lucky to even have that set. That's also the belts in the territories. Even though sometimes guys were lackadaisical, for the most part, they got more respect than the belts do today because it was the only one. When you won the belt, it was the same belt that all those great wrestlers in that territory or that company had had before you, and you better goddamn take care of it, and you better have it ready to drop back when the time is right, or you probably never work that territory again, and they'll probably hold up your check for however long or whatever. But there was only one belt, and there were no replicas. So fans had to make their own. Now, the fans have better-looking belts than the goddamn wrestlers do, especially the ones that were in the old days when the guy had it in his bag every night and hitting opponents over the head with it. The fans' belts now look better than the belts did back then. But they don't mean as much. So, I'm all for if guys during their career win a particular belt that they really think looked cool and they want to buy their own, but I think that would be the most markish thing in the world for the company to give replicas of the belts to the fucking guys. I don't. Oh my God.
What do you think of fans bringing replica belts to shows?
Well, I mean, I don't have any problem with them doing it. That's why I just said the fans have better look. I'm amazed constantly, continuously. Every time I see it, the fans have better looking belts than the promotions did in the old. And sometimes the promotions still do because that fan takes care of it. They're not getting hit over the head with the thing every day.
No, they're just walking around an arena with it over their shoulder like they won something.
Oh, you mean like a just a wrestling show rather than a fan fest?
Yeah, well, even a fan fest. Well, why are people walking around with belts?
Usually to get them signed. I can understand that.
That's different. That's different. Yes.
Yeah. No. If you just dress up like you won the Mankato heavyweight championship and just wander around like a goof and you're not getting anything signed and you think you really are a champion, then you're kind of a mark, no matter where the situation. But if you have belts and a belt collection and you bring one to get signed or whatever, I am fully in favor of that.
When I was a kid and I used to go to the Nassau Coliseum for shows, there was another kid who always had this belt, and it was a complete bullshit belt. Like, it didn't look like the Winged Eagle belt or any of the famous belts you knew. It was just a wrestling belt that he got somewhere, and he would always have it, and he just loved the attention he got for having this belt at the shows. And then I remember one time we were hanging out across the street at the hotel afterwards, and he walks in with the fucking belt. Like, he went everywhere with it.
Hey, I think belts have been somewhat devalued because of the ease and accessibility of same to where they don't have the same mystique they used to. I remember the first time when I started, taking pictures, doing photography at the gardens, when I actually got the chance to get up close to the belt and take a picture of it. Wow. Now there's brand new, beautiful championship belts available everywhere. Everybody can have one, whether it's been used in wrestling or not, same material. And they're not particularly as special anymore. And I wish that the promotions, instead of making also all those, the WWF or WWE belts just have a big W on them, right? Just almost all of them.
So ugly.
Everything looks the same. Couldn't they make some type of modern belt that you can't do a replica of exactly? They could sell kind of like lower quality versions, but their own. I mean, it's like if for our fans and friends across the pond, if you could buy the crown jewels at the local Boots drugstore and they were the exact same quality as the crown jewels, would the crown jewels mean that much anymore? I don't know. Something to ponder. You know when I do my best pondering, Brian?
When is that?
When I'm shaving my balls. Because I'll tell you, you need to make a lot of a lot. You need to pay a lot of attention when you're shaving your balls, because you don't want to have any mishaps, but you can also ponder well at the same time. And actually, you can ponder and shave best at the same time when you use the products from our friends at Manscaped. Because once again, even if you did happen to think, well, you know, maybe I should have that championship belt, and you weren't paying attention and you ran the trimmer right into the base of your dick with a regular old barber trimmer, you might give yourself a do-it-yourself vasectomy. But with the Lawnmower 3.0 trimmer, you won't even nick yourself. You won't feel it. That's because you can't nick yourself with the Lawnmower 3.0. I've tried. It just doesn't happen. Or the Weed Whacker ear and nose hair trimmer can help you whack those nasty weeds in whatever delicate hole that you might be wanting to put it into. No nicks, no snags, no tugs. The Crop Preserver deodorant for your balls, because after all, they have to smell good. Or even if you've got smelly feet, the Foot Duster foot deodorant. You don't know what the Crop Mop ball wipes, just in case. Always on the go, even in a pandemic, if you want to have a slobber session. But wipe your balls with the Crop Mops. Refined cologne by Manscaped. You can spritz it in the trouble areas or just around the nape of the neck or behind the ear. People will be following you down the road saying, boy, he smells like a New Orleans whorehouse. That is good. Anyway, whatever you want to do to your body in the way of freshening up, whacking the weeds, or making it smell better, folks, you can do it with our fine friends at Manscaped.com and the products that they provide. And whether I'm talking about the Lawnmower 3.0 or the Weed Whacker or the Performance Package, the Crop Preserver, the Foot Duster, the Refined Cologne, no matter what, you can get 20% off and free shipping if you go to manscaped.com and use the code DRIVE, D-R-I-V-E. Winter is coming. We're going to have warmer clothes. Warmer clothes leads to more body sweat. More body sweat leads to mildew. Mildew leads to crotch rot. Do not let your dick get crotch rot. Go to manscaped.com. 20% off, free shipping, and no crotch rot with the code DRIVE, D-R-I-V-E. Be sure to join the Manscaped movement and spend more time inside this winter with your balls.